हेलो एवरीवन, टुडे विल बी सीइंग हाउ टू डिराइव अ रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन अ कार्टेशियन कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम एंड नेचुरल कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम। सो इन द प्रीवियस सेशन यू हैव स्टडीड व्हाट यू मीन बाय अ कार्टेशियन कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम, व्हाट इज़ अ लोकल कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम एंड व्हाट इज़ नेचुरल कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम। सो अपार्ट फ्रॉम ऑल दिस थिंग, नेचुरल कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम इज़ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट कोऑर्डिनेट सिस्टम बिकॉज वेन एवर आई वॉन्ट टू डिराइव द स्टिफनेस मैट्रिक्स और the load vectors in such cases, instead of going with the Cartesian coordinate system, I can easily go with the natural coordinate system. Because what is the need of this natural coordinate system is its range is only unity. So it starts from minus 1 left side and it ends with plus 1. So if I'm doing any integration with respect to this natural coordinate system, I'll be getting I will be getting a very easy way to solve this particular problem. So for this to get the relationship, so sometimes what happens, we are deriving the things with respect to a Cartesian coordinate system. So if I take an element, so this is called as an line element or a 1D element, which is used to solve the bar problem. So if I see this 1D element, I can represent this 1D element both in natural as well as Cartesian coordinate system. So if I go with the natural coordinate system, if you see here, this is the element, okay? This is the element. At the center of this element, I'll take it as a origin for the natural coordinate system. I'll represent this natural coordinate system in the form of a dimensionless number, that is zeta here for x-axis. So zeta will be 0 at this particular point, zeta will be plus 1 at this particular point, and zeta will be minus 1 in the right side. So this is the range of this coordinate system. Any element you take it, you will mark the center, that will be the origin. Whatever comes at the left hand side, it will be positive side. Sorry, I made a mistake here. This will be minus 1 and this will be plus 1. This will be minus 1 and this will be plus 1. So left side will be a negative parameter and right side will be a positive parameter. Coming with the Cartesian coordinate system, which you have discussed in the previous. So this is the same element here. This is the same element. If you can write the nodes also. So there are two nodes. This is first node and this is second node. This is first node and this is second node. Okay. So if you see here, the first node is given by the dimension x1 with a fixed coordinate system. So this is a coordinate axis. From this coordinate axis, it is x1 here, and this point is x2. Okay? And if I want to know the length of this element, will be x2 minus x1 will be the length of this element. So this is how we'll be what we call it as representing the element in the Cartesian coordinate system and in the natural coordinate system. But every time, this is a simple problem here. When complicated problems are there where thousands of elements are there, in that case, this Cartesian coordinate system will be a tedious process because I have already explained you. So everything, whether we can convert this Cartesian coordinate system into a natural coordinate system, we have to see, and it is possible here, and we can derive the equation where Cartesian coord what is the relationship between a Cartesian coordinate system and a natural coordinate system. Okay, so we have taken an example or element here where it is called as a line element. So as we all know, the center is zeta is equal to 0, here minus 1, here plus 1, at any random point. Okay, I have marked a random point and I have taken it as a zeta. I don't know the value of that, I've just taken a random value zeta. So in the Cartesian coordinate system, same thing, the nomenclature is being done here. This is x1, this is x2. The same point I'll take it as a random point. I'll say a same point, I'll take it as a random point, and I name it as x. Okay. Now both the element are same, but only represented in different direction. Okay, in different, sorry, different coordinate system. So if I take the ratios of this particular line element, both the ratios should be equal. The ratios of both the coordinates should be equal. So for example, if I take AB by AC, okay, so AB by AC if I take, this is AB, this is AC if I take, and this is in the natural coordinate system. And if I take the same ratio in the Cartesian coordinate system, both should be equal, okay, because the ratio will be always equal here. So if I see here, what is AB? Okay, what is AB? You have to check what is AB. So AB, if I apply the distance formula, you know the coordinates. If I apply the distance formula, okay, so x2 minus x1, if I do it, x2, which is zeta here, zeta minus of minus 1 divided by, what is here, AC is there, so it will become 1 minus of minus 1, 1 minus of minus 1. Once again, I'll explain. At any random point zeta, zeta is not equal to 0. We have not taken at the center, we have taken at a random point B. So at a random point, I have just nomenclatured B as a zeta. Okay. So if I want to know the distance of this AB, AB is zeta minus of minus 1, because already we know the value of zeta here. So here AC is plus 1 minus of minus 1, we have written here. So similarly, if I go with the Cartesian coordinate system, so if you see here, AB is what here, x minus x1. So this is the length, x minus x1 is AB, and AC is what, x2 minus x1. This is x1, this is x2. AC will be x2 minus x1. So now if I just add them up, zeta plus 1 divided by 2 is equal to x minus x1 upon x2 minus x1. Okay, so then if I try to, I'll take it at the top side. If I want, what is only zeta here, so zeta will be equal to 2 into x minus x1 upon x2 minus x1. Here plus 1 is there, this becomes minus 1. This becomes minus 1. So this is the relationship between a Cartesian coordinate system and a natural coordinate system. See, I have told you the advantage of natural coordinate system, because it is very easy to integrate. Okay, so whenever you feel that a Cartesian coordinate term is coming in, that you can use this relationship to replace that Cartesian coordinate term using this natural coordinate term, that is zeta, and you know the relationship. So it is necessary to understand this relationship and remember that, okay, so that it is very much used in the next in, whatever the derivations we are doing. See, what we are doing in this particular chapter is we are trying to solve the a bar problem, beam problem, truss problem by using an FEM method, which is a matrix method. Okay, so in order to solve a matrix method, what we are doing is we are using a simple relationship. F is equal to K into U. This is a simple relationship which we are using. Force is equal to stiffness into displacement. Okay, so our motto in this FEM particular this chapter is to find out the displacement. Okay, to find out the displacement. So in order to find out the displacement, this is F, which is an applied force, which will be there in the problem definition. K is called as a stiffness matrix. Okay, so you'll get a matrix which will cover the geometrical and its material properties, which will have the matrix which covers the geometrical and material property. So in order to get this relation or get this formula, we are doing all this conversions. Okay, so with respect to this, we'll end up to find the what we call it as stiffness of the material. So after getting this, okay, we will be able to solve the problems. So only we are doing this type of calculations. So now I hope you have understood this, how to convert a natural coordinate system, Cartesian coordinate system into a natural coordinate system, or vice versa, you have a relationship there. Okay, so next we'll be seeing one important what we call it as a formula or a relationship or a concept called as a shape function. Okay, so shape function, we'll be trying to understand that. shape function. Okay, so what do you mean by a shape function? So whenever whenever we are solving the FEM problems, we will be getting I'll just explain you guys. Okay, so this I'll take as an element, a single element, which is a line element. This is one element which has two nodes, which has two nodes. Okay, so in FEM, okay, the problem is every time whatever your displacement values are you are getting, you will be getting on the nodes only. Okay, so if you have two nodes, you will be getting two displacements. So that I'll call this as a U1 displacement and a U2 displacement. Whatever displacement you are getting is called as a nodal displacement. Okay, this is called as a nodal. This is a logic which we use in FEM. Only on the nodes only you will be getting the displacement, or you will not get at any point. At any point you will be not getting the relationship. So I need to find a logic, okay, I need to find a relationship to know that at any point, okay, at any point if I want to find out the displacement of that, what will be the relationship. Okay, by FEM I can calculate only U1 and U2. Okay, by using that F is equal to K into U, which you have done in the spring problem. Okay, whenever you are solving that spring problem, you have calculated what is U1, what is U2 and what is U3. The similar ground, FEM, in FEM only you will be getting the nodal displacements. Okay, nodal displacements you will be getting. But at any point, see, for example, if I take this as an element, or this as a bar, I'll convert this bar into an element as a one dimensional element. So this is one node, this is other node. So I'll be getting the displacement at this point and this point when you solve it in a FEM solution. But if I want to know at any point, so this is origin here, at any point of this body, if I want to know the value of the displacement, I should have a relationship. I should have a relationship with respect to displacement at any point. Okay, so that displacement at any point is given by a parameter called as a shape function. Okay, so that is a equation which will give you the parameter. This is a parameter, that is, we'll be designating it as n. We'll be designating it as a n. So here what we are doing is u of x is nothing but the displacement at any point. Okay, so in other term, this u of x is called as the field variable. You have to remember this, field variable. Okay, this is called as a field variable. U of x is called as a field variable, whereas ui is called as a nodal displacement. Nodal displacement. Okay, nodal displacement. So understand this, what is a shape function? So shape function is always an interpolation model. Okay, understand that interpolation model is, it will give the relationship between the field variable. Field variable is nothing but displacement at any point. Okay, displacement at any point, we call it as a field variable. And what is nodal displacement? Displacement on nodes. Okay, but I have told you the logic, in FEM you will be getting only nodal displacements. Okay, but if I want to know at exactly at a certain point, if I want to know what is the displacement of that, I should have a relationship which gives the relationship between a field variable and a nodal displacement. So that is called as a shape function, where ni is nothing but the shape function. Okay, it is nothing but the shape function. So shape function is nothing but, it is an interpolation model. It is an interpolation model. So you know what is interpolation. Okay, interpolation model, or we call it as an interpolation relation. Interpolation relation which gives between the field variable and the nodal displacement. Okay, so we'll get to know, we'll try to get a relationship for a displacement at any point. Okay, with the help of a shape function. How to derive the shape functions we'll get to know now. So next we will be starting with so I hope what is the shape function you got to know. So now what we are doing is we will be deriving that shape function for a line element in Cartesian coordinate system. See, what is the, whenever we are taking an interpolation model is nothing but the relationship, that is x minus x1, x2 minus x1, like that we will be giving the interpolation model. So a coordinate system is very much required whenever we are deriving the shape function or relationship between a field variable and the nodal displacement. So we will be first deriving the shape function in Cartesian coordinate system. Okay, so we'll just write down shape function in Cartesian coordinate system. See, this Cartesian coordinate system can also be called as global. Okay, sometimes in some book they have written it as a global coordinate system. So Cartesian can be written it as a global coordinate system. So I'll just draw this. What I'll do is I'll not take y axis here. I'll just take x axis because I've taken an element. Okay, I've taken an element which is having two nodes. This is first node and this is second node. So I'll write it at the top. This is first node, this is second node. Okay, so I'll name this displacement or the position of first node as x1. Okay, and position of second node as x2. Okay, now what I want to is I want the displacement at this particular point. I want at a random point. I want a displacement at this particular point. So I'll call this as a distance x. Okay, understand this. You know that nodal displacements at this point we will be getting u1 displacement. Okay, it is free to move now. It is free to move. There is no any constraint here. It is free to move. At this particular point, you will be getting a u2 displacement. U1 displacement at this particular point, and where we are getting a U2 displacement. Okay, so this is the setup. So at x1 you are getting U1 and x2 you are getting U2 displacement, but I am interested at a some point x. Okay, some point x I am interested. So I will be trying to find out the value of that shape function which will give the relationship. So how we are doing this is, first we'll write the displacement model. So displacement model, if you write, I'll be taking a, already you are known the how to write the displacement model. Displacement model. So for this line element, we used to take it u is equal to a naught plus a1x. U is equal to a naught plus a1x. This was the linear model which we have taken. So next we'll apply the boundary conditions for this. So applying boundary conditions, what are the boundary conditions? At x is equal to, first I'll apply on the first node, at x is equal to what? X1. At x is equal to x1, what will be u? U is equal to u1. Okay, u is equal to u1. So I'll apply this u1 equal to a naught plus a1 x1, a naught plus a1 x1. So next I'll take the second boundary condition. At x is equal to x2, at x is equal to x2, what is u? U is equal to u2, at u is equal to u2. So u2 is nothing but a naught plus a1 x2, a naught plus a1 x2. I hope it is clear. Okay, so now you got these two relationships. Okay, these two relationships you got. So from this you have to calculate the values of a naught and a1. So how we'll calculate this a naught and a1? This is equation A, this is equation B. So if you do a minus b, you will be getting the solution out of this. Okay, so if I do u1 minus u2, okay, so if I do u1 minus u2, a0 minus what we call it, a0 gets cancelled, a1 remains as it is. So what you are getting is, you are getting x1 minus x2, okay, x1 minus x2. I hope it is clear. X1 minus x2 you are getting. So yeah, or instead what we will do is, you yeah, it is same, u1 minus u2 is a1 x1 minus x2, or a1 is equal to u1 excuse me, u1 minus u2 is nothing but x1 minus x2. Or what I'll do is, I'll take x2 first and x1 afterwards. I'll just interchange the values or multiply by minus. So a1 will be u2 minus u1 upon x2 minus x1. Okay, I can write. Okay, now you got a1. I'll be substituting a1 in equation A. Okay, so u1 is equal to a0 plus u2 minus u1 upon x2 minus x1 into x1. Okay, into x1. So what you will be getting here is, so you will be getting a0 is equal to u1 minus u2 minus u1 upon x2 minus x1 into x1. Okay, so if you take the LCM part here, so what you are getting here is, I'll just rub it out here. A naught is equal to u1 x2. Okay, u1 x2 minus u1 x1 minus u2 x1 minus u1 x1 divided by x2 minus x1. Okay, so you are getting this. So what all the things we are eliminating here is u1 x1 and u1 x1 gets eliminated. So a0 is, what you are getting is u1 x2 minus u2 x1 divided by x2 minus x1. Okay, x2 minus x1. So if you see here, x2 minus x1, x2 minus x1 is nothing but the length of the element. Okay, so we'll do that in the later cases. I'll just substitute all the values in that equation. U is equal to a0 plus a1x. You had this equation. Okay, so I'll just put this equation here. So u1 x2 minus u2 x1 divided by x2 minus x1 plus a1 is u2 minus u1 into x divided by x2 minus x1. Okay, so what is this means? If I take common LCM, you will be getting just solve this side. So we'll be getting x2 minus x1 as a LCM part. Okay, so you'll be getting it as u1 x2 minus u2 x1 plus u2 x minus u1 x. Okay, u1 x. So this is u of x. U of x. Okay, so now what I'll do is, I'll just as you heard about the shape function definition, shape function is nothing but an interpolation function which will give the relationship between a field variable and the nodal displacement. So u of x is a field variable. I should get an interpolation function out of this with respect to the displacement, okay, nodal displacement. So what I'll do is I'll take u1 common and u2 common. So if I take a u1 common, so what I'll get, so u1 common, if I take, I'll be getting x2 minus x, and plus if I take u2 common, I'll be getting x minus x1. So upon x2 minus x1, so which is nothing but u of x is x2 minus x upon x2 minus x1 into u1 plus u2 into x minus x1 upon x2 minus x1, x2 minus x1. Okay, so this is how we will be solving the relationship. So if I see this relation, this is x2 minus x upon x2 minus x1. So this is the interpolation function. This is the interpolation function which will be giving you the relationship between the field variable and the nodal displacement. So u of x is nothing but n1 u1 plus n2 u2. So this n1 is the shape function for the first nodal displacement, n2 is the shape function for the second nodal displacement. So what you will be getting here is, so what you will be getting here is n1 is nothing but x2 minus x, okay, upon x2 minus x1, n2 is x minus x1 upon x2 minus x1, okay. So if you see here, x2 minus x, x2 minus x1, x2 minus x1 is nothing but the length of the element. So here x minus x1 divided by the length of the element. So like this, we will be converting, or we will be getting a relationship between a field variable and the nodal displacement with the help of the shape function. Okay, with the help of the shape function. So now I'll be solving the same thing by using the natural coordinate system. Okay, so you have got this values. So n1 is x2 minus x upon le, and n2 is x minus x1 upon le. So this is for the Cartesian coordinate system, or call it as a global coordinate system. The same thing we'll be solving with respect to a natural coordinate system, and then I'll explain you what is the what are the properties of this shape functions, and then we'll be going for the other part. Okay. Kitna time? So now we'll be seeing how to derive the shape function in the natural coordinate system. In the previous we have studied how to derive the shape function in global coordinate system. If you see here, these are the values for the global coordinate system. Now we'll be seeing how to derive the equation in the natural coordinate system. So this is same thing, the same procedure we'll be applying to get the values of the n1 and n2. So I will be writing the relationship. Okay, so first what we do, we write the displacement model. Okay, displacement model we'll write. So we have to write this displacement model in terms of natural coordinate system, in terms of natural coordinate system. So u of zeta I'll take. So instead of a field variable, you have to take it as u of x. In natural coordinate system, we'll take it as u of zeta. U of zeta is nothing but a naught plus a1 zeta. A naught plus a1 zeta. This is the linear model which we are writing in terms of natural coordinate system. So then what I'll do, I'll apply the boundary conditions. I'll apply the boundary conditions. So what are the boundary conditions at? See here. First at node 1, so I can write it here, it has a node 1 and node 2. At node 1, what is the value of zeta? At zeta is equal to minus 1, u is equal to u1. Okay, so I will write here it as u1 displacement, and here it is u2 displacement. So here If I apply for this equation, u1 is equal to a0 minus a1, because zeta is minus 1. So at zeta is equal to plus 1, u is equal to u2. So what you will get? U2 is equal to a0 plus a2. A0 plus a1. So you got these two equations here. You got these two equations. If you solve them, you will be getting the values of a0 and a1. So if I do u1 minus u2, a0 and a0 gets cancelled. So what you will be getting here is minus 2a1. So if I do minus multiplication all the side, if I want to eliminate this minus here, so it 2a1 is equal to u2 minus u1. Okay,
so what will be a1 equal to u2 minus u1 divided by 2. U2 minus u1 divided by 2. So similarly, if I apply this a1 in this any of the equations, so you have u1 is equal to a0 minus a1, what you have written? It is u2 minus u1 divided by 2. So what I'll do? I just substitute here. Okay, I just substitute here. So a0 is nothing but equal to u1 plus u2 minus u1 divided by 2. So a0 is 2u1 plus u2 minus u1 divided by 2. If you do this, so you will be getting a0 is equal to u1 plus u2 divided by 2. Okay, so you got what is the value of a0 and what is the value of a1. So I just substitute in the equation here. So what is that equation?
Shape function.